2 years ago, I was working on the Odoo JavaScript codebase. It was painful. I was sad and depressed, lonely. Why was it so frustrating to combine widgets together, to coordinate them, to add an event listener, and then to remove it properly? Why was it so difficult? My life was joyless, empty, void. But then, we had a dream. We had a dream about the perfect developer experience. We imagined what it should be, and so was born OWL in an explosion of light, butterflies, and rainbow. Obviously, I'm lying. It was not the way it worked, but the point still stands. Working on the Odoo JavaScript codebase is a mixed experience. It's full of joy sometimes, but frustrating some other times. You may know what I'm talking about. There was a need for a change. We needed to find a way to be able to maintain a complex application such as the Odoo web client for the long term. So we decided to work on a new JavaScript framework. And that's what this talk is about. My name is Jerry Debonny. I'm a lead developer at Odoo, working on the Odoo JavaScript codebase, mostly on JavaScript projects. And today, for this technical talk, I will explain why Odoo decided to make OWL, why it is a good framework, and how we can work with it in the future. So let's get started for the first topic. Why OWL? I think it's worth taking some time explaining why we embarked in such a crazy project. Obviously, we are aware that creating a new framework from scratch is crazy. Why would we do that when there are well-maintained, well-done, well-designed other frameworks? Well, it's a question that we asked ourselves a lot of times. We took a lot of time to think about that, and we came to the conclusion that while those other frameworks had many qualities, they did not fit our need. So let me highlight three good reasons for that. First, OWL is based on XML documents. And as you know, XML documents are a pretty big part of the Odoo extensibility story. The way Odoo works is that you have a lot of XML documents, hundreds of thousands of lines of XML, and you apply XPath on them to transform them, to modify them dynamically. That's very powerful, and you don't want to lose this property. Sadly, most frameworks are not based on XML templates. They use their own render functions or their own custom templating language. This makes it kind of awkward to use those frameworks for Odoo because we would need either to give up XML documents, which is impossible, or we would need some kind of translation layers to go from the XML layer to the template layer. And that would lose a lot of value if we wanted to use Vue or maybe React. It would make it much more difficult because the Odoo developer, would then need to know the two layers at the same time. Okay, so that's one of the first and big reasons why those frameworks may not fit our needs. Another one, which is really surprising, is that Odoo requires just-in-time template compilation. This is actually kind of the opposite of the state of the art. Currently, most frameworks try to build those templates the earliest moment possible. And for example, Svelte, which is one of the new kids on the block, Svelte tries to erase himself from the build. And that's really not what Odoo needs. Odoo needs to compile those templates at the latest time possible because we actually don't know what the template will look like when it is run. The main reason for that is that it depends on mostly on the add-ons that are installed. It depends on the customization by the customer. So we need to be able to compile our templates dynamically. That's a pretty big problem for those main frameworks. Another issue is that we want this framework to integrate easily in the way Odoo manage its assets. And that's a big issue. It may be a self-constrained issue, but it's a big problem because it's not trivial at all. Odoo is a big suite of add-ons, and all of them need to be managed, built, minified, bundled together. And it makes it really difficult to integrate with the tooling proposed by those mainstream frameworks. Because of that, it was really kind of difficult to use those frameworks, and at the same time, it would make the experience much worse than using than starting a new React project. Therefore, we started working on the old framework, which has those nice properties and which is custom built for our needs. Now that you see the why, let's talk about the design principles behind OWL. OWL is a nice toolbox, but it's like all tools, it is designed for some specific use and may not be appropriate for other cases. So let's talk about that. First, OWL is designed to be a low-level framework. It's designed to stay out of your way. It does not solve all your architectural design issues. It will simply provide you with a bunch of tools and a bunch of powerful tools, but you need to be able to combine them. At its core, OWL is supposed to replace the widget system in the Odoo framework. The widget system that was imperative is difficult. It may have some good qualities, but it was complicated. And that was the main motivation to replace those widgets by our OWL components. So OWL is designed to be low level, to stay out of your way. It's also quite small, and it won't grow that much, I expect. Finally, OWL provides a modern user interface toolset. It's a nice toolbox. We looked at all of the other frameworks currently mainstream, and we tried to understand what the value of each concept IDs was. And some of them had really powerful IDs. For example, React provided this new, a few years ago, this new ID of hooks. And this ID was simple, composable, had a lot of nice property. Therefore, we tried to replicate this good property into our own frameworks. But OWL also provides you with components, hooks, store management, state management, reactivity, and a lot of powerful abstraction in a small box. So that's really a nice, coherent experience that involves all of the main IDs that we could understand and make good use of. Also, and I'm very proud of this one, OWL is probably one of the best, in my opinion, on the concurrency side of the equation. So, as you may know, widgets in Odoo are complicated, but they have one good quality. They can coordinate themselves for asynchronous rendering pipeline. So you can have one component, one widget, which waits for its sub-widgets to be rendered before rendering itself, applying itself. It was nice, and we kept that good property and improved it by a lot in the OWL framework. The OWL framework is async by default. Every single component in an OWL component tree is rendered in its own call stack. It's a small detail, but it means that the concurrency model implies that for developer, it composes very well. You don't need to change anything except one component if you want to turn it asynchronous. You do not have to propagate any change upstream. And that's very powerful. And this rendering system is based, just like React, on this idea of fibers, which keeps track of any part of the rendering process and make sure that you can cancel them, restart rendering, and stuff like that. It's a very powerful concurrency model which works by default. So I'm very proud of that. It's probably the most technically difficult part of OWL. So it's a nice, really a powerful tool that you have to build asynchronous user interface. Right. Now, enough theory. Those were just big words to tell you what OWL is good for and what OWL is not designed to be. Now, let's start working with OWL. Let's build a real application. We will do a task list application, and we will explain a lot of concepts along the way. So, the application will be a simple component, which we will let the user enter new tasks in an input. Those tasks are just a list of text, and they can be toggled to mark them as completed. And finally, they can be deleted as well. So, very simple project, but nice enough and interesting enough to play with a lot of OWL concepts. Obviously, the result will be completely over-engineered for what it's for, but it will just be an excuse to introduce nice and interesting concepts. So let's get started. First step, which is not the most interesting step, is setting up the project. Since it's not really OWL specific, or it's not really since it really depends on your need, because a real project would need to use extra additional tools such as a bundler, need to a server, HTML server, whatever. For our situation, what we'll do is the simplest OWL project possible, which is an HTML file, a JavaScript file, a CSS file, and that's it. That's what we're going to do. So it's not really interesting, but that way we have a playground to introduce our application. Let me tell you also that all the code for this talk is available on my personal repository, on this OWL to-do list repository. You can find one commit for each main step of this talk. So please feel free to check this commit, this repository out, to play with it, to have fun, and to learn if you are interested. All right. Now let's move to the first real OWL work. We will do the equivalent of a Hello World in the JavaScript world. In this case, it's simply be able to display some static text inside your HTML page. Very simple. What we want to do is to do it with a component. We will have a root component, which is app, and this component will contain the rest of your user interface. As you can see in the code on your right, all components are based on are subclasses of the component class exported by OWL. This is the way OWL define each component. Just one single way, extending a component class. Okay. An OWL application is then a dynamic tree of components starting from that one, from app, and we need to mount it because on the top of your screen, it's just defined. You need to instantiate it yourself, only the root, that's done in the setup function, and then to mount it inside the DOM, in this case, document body. Okay. One thing I should mention is that in this talk, I use the XML helper, as you can see, to define the template. I do it for one reason. This helper helps me defining inline templates easily. It will register them to the OWL rendering engine. It's really helpful for such a talk, for documentation, stuff like that. But in a real application, you will probably not want to use such an helper because inline templates defined like that cannot be translated. They cannot be expanded, extended, and so on. So, for most of use cases, I don't expect your template to be inline. But for this talk, that's what we are going to do. It's much simpler. Okay, we now have our first component, to-do app. What we want to do is to extend it, to modify it, to display a list of tasks. We'll do this process gradually. We have an empty, we have just a div with some text. Now we want to display a list of tasks. To do that, it's really helpful to use demo data because it forces us to think about what the data structure should look like, how the state is defined. In this case, I define a task list, a list object on the top of your screen. And each task is defined by a title, and a flag is completed, which describe if the task is done or is not done yet. Okay, the title is the description of the task. Maybe you could expand this model with additional fields, but it's not required for this talk. Also, notice that I added an ID. A unique ID field is very, very important in many cases, as you probably know. And it's in particular, it's very important when you need to display list of components or list of things. It's really critical to the way a framework works. But luckily, most of the time in the real world, we have a natural ID for each object. It's usually the ID of a record in a database, and it's guaranteed to be unique. So we'll kind of simulate with this list real data coming from some database. Now, once we have this task list, we need to use it inside in a template. Let's have a look at this app template. This template is very simple. It's basically a T4Each, which is a standard QWeb directive. T4Each directive is just described the fact that you want to iterate on each task. And now is a good time to tell you something very important about the evaluation context. A template for a component is rendered in some QWeb evaluation context, but this is not anything. It's very precisely the instance of your component. So in this case, you need to provide in your component the task object. Since I define it on the top of your screen, you need to add it as a class field for your app component. So that's what's done in the bottom of the screen. Okay. Now that tasks is available in your app instance, it can be used in your template as a tasks object. You don't need to do this point task when you are describing a template. And then a very important point is that OWL is actually not a QWeb engine. It's an extension of a QWeb engine. It has more property. It adds more directive. In this case, it adds a T-key directive. And this T-key directive is very important. It gives, it describes to OWL the identity of your task. This means that this is the way OWL can make the difference between a task that was changed or two tasks that are removed and replaced by a different one. Because of that key, OWL can make the difference and properly react. So very important, whenever you use a T for each in OWL, you should add a T key attribute. Okay, the rest is not that much interesting. You have a T-ATT checked directive, which is a dynamic attribute, which can use a task element. And you have a T-ESC, which gives you the title. And this will give you the small task list that you can see on the bottom left of your screen. This is the result of this template. Now, let's take a moment to style it. That's what this CSS file does. And I want just to stop 1 minute to give a new property given by OWL compared to the old QWeb engine. The OWL QWeb engine is able to combine class together. So by that I mean you have a static class attribute, class, which is task, and you have a dynamic class attribute, which is task point, which is done in this case. It may appear or not. And OWL is aware of that you have two attributes and combine them. So if your task is done, your div element will get the task class and done class at the same time. That's very convenient in the real world. Okay, so that was a small side point. Now, most user interfaces are built as a tree of components. You have the root tree, the root component, which has sub-components, which may have sub-components, and so on. And that's a pretty big shift from Odoo, because in Odoo, working with widgets was kind of frustrating, was kind of awkward. So the best practice when you were working with widgets may have been to kind of have one big widget, because it's much easier to manage one widget than to combine them together. But all is designed for to make it easy, because it's a declarative framework. So since it's so easy, you are free to choose the granularity that you prefer. You may choose a lot of components, or some components, or just one. You do it the way it makes sense for your needs. Okay. In our case, I think it makes sense to extract each task as a subcomponent. There is no performance issue here. OWL is totally fine with 20,000 subcomponents. So you don't need to worry about that. You can just extract tasks as a subcomponent. So let's do that. And that's very interesting, because now we have a need to be able to describe to OWL how it should render subcomponents. And the way it's done is by using this static components key that you can see in the app class. You see, there is a static components key which contains the instance, no, sorry, not the instance, the class component that define a task. That's on the top part of this code. And the fact that you have this static components key gives all the mapping between a name and a class. Okay, and that's critical, because when you look at the app template now, all the code for a given task has been extracted away, has been moved away and replaced by a task tag. And this task tag is capitalized. It has a capital first letter. And that is the clue for all to decide if this tag represents a component instead of an HTML tag. So remember, capital letter means component, lowercase letter means standard HTML tag. Another point that you should have a look on this template is that this task component is given some information. It has another attribute, task, which is actually bound to the task object that it represents. And this is the way the parent component can configure, set up a children component. That's why it gives it as an attribute, it gives it information. And now this information is available in the task component under the props special key. It's a props. And as you can see in the template has been changed to read information in this props object. Okay, there's a lot to think about, but this is, if you study this this code, it tried to describe an interface. It tried to describe a tree of components. The root is the app component, and then you have all of these tasks as a subcomponent. And all of these tasks contains get the information from their parents. That's what this slide is about. So you really need to understand the way state is managed in OWL, or in any other framework, by the way. But this is not specific to OWL. But it's critical to see that each component can manage its own state. That's really important. The state is local to one component. It's owned by the component. And a component can give reference to some part of its state to its children. But then it will be accessed not under the children state object or any object. It will be accessed available in the props object, which is special, which is different for each component. And I think it's time to describe the difference between those two. And that's because that's really, really, really important. The main issue is ownership. We need to be able to say that some piece of data is owned by some piece of code. And that's really critical, because you don't want the same piece of data to be shared between many components. Because if one of them update this information, if one of them change it, if one of them change it in a different way, and you have another component that may do some incompatible change or may be corrupted, it will not be good. So it's really important to make sure that it's clear in everyone's head that what piece of what component, what piece of code owns which piece of state. That's really important. Okay, so that's the state. And so, but in practice, we want to give our state to our children component. That's really critical. You see, we have a task list. The app component wants to give its state to its task component. So it does it in a props object. And this props object is not owned by the subcomponent. It's just something that you should consider read-only. It cannot be updated. That's really, really important. And I believe that it's actually a really good, nice way to modelize a user interface. And that's really different from what we did with the widgets in Odoo, where this distinction between the own state and state from someone else was not made clear by the framework. Therefore, we made some mistake and we had some problem with that. State is owned by some component and given as a props to other components, but they cannot modify that. Okay, I think that the point is made. So let's keep working. We want to give the possibility to the user to add tasks, because for now, even though we have two subcomponents, it's not really a dynamic, useful widget, because it just display two tasks and that's it. You want the user to add its own tasks. To do that, we will modify the application template on your top right, and we will add an input with an event handler. We need to listen to some specific event. We want to listen to the keyUp event in this case, because that keyUp event is triggered when the user press enter. So, to do that, we have another new directive. It's an OWL extension for QWeb. It's a TON directive. This directive will bind automatically an event listener to the HTML element. And that's very convenient to do it that way. This event listener is named addTask. So it should be some valid method from the QWeb evaluation context. And that QWeb evaluation context, what is it? It's the app instance. Therefore, you need to add an addTask method to your application class. That's what is done on the bottom right. This event simply listen to the keyUp event, detect if it's an enter, and in that case, it will empty the input, so the user can enter a new task, and it will do something that we will do just later. For now, it will just log to the console the name, the text entered by the user. Okay. The main point is that OWL makes it easy in this example to add an event listener and to react to some event. Now, it's not done yet, but let's take a break and let's just discuss how we can make that input auto-focused. Because whenever you refresh your user interface, you want the focus to be already set at the proper location. And this will be an example for two important OWL concepts. The hooks, one hook which will be useRef, and the lifecycle methods for components. Components have a set of lifecycle methods. One of them is mounted. Mounted is a callback. You can see that it has a callback that will be called whenever your component is put inside the DOM. So at this moment, it has been rendered, it has a valid element, a valid DOM, and it's inside the DOM. It's very important lifecycle method. And what we want to do in that mounted method, we want to focus the input. And how can we do that? We need a reference to the input. We could simply do a query selector, but it's kind of unsafe to do that because you don't know what the DOM of your final application may be, so it's fragile. Maybe you have other components that may have other inputs, so you don't want to focus these inputs. So it's not performant. You need to look up in the DOM, which is kind of stupid because you actually render the DOM yourself. So you know where the input is. So how can you keep a reference to that input with the tref new directive? This tref directive simply adds a name to an HTML element, and you can read that information in the input ref element. This point input ref. Which will let you give you a reference to the input that you can focus then. So this code, the code that you see in mounted, cannot be done before. If you do that code in the constructor, it will fail because the DOM is not rendered yet. And I think it's a good opportunity to mention the full component lifecycle in OWL. It's pretty standard, so there is nothing really incredibly surprising in this component lifecycle. Let me mention a few things nevertheless. We want to talk about the constructor first. The constructor is called whenever your component is created, not by you, but by, when it's created. And it's the time where you want to apply your hooks. Hooks are only valid when they are applied at the constructor time. If you do that later, it's too late. You will probably it will probably not work. Another point interesting thing to mention is the will start hook. The will start hook is really actually inspired by the will start method on those widgets in Odoo. And this is very important. It's an asynchronous method that will that can perform any kind of work. For example, it can fetch data to the server, and it will delay the rendering of your component. So it's the way OWL took the best ideas from the widget system and applied them to a component lifecycle method. Other notable methods is mounted and will unmount. Those are, just like the name suggests, those are called whenever your component is rendered and available in the DOM, and whenever it will be removed from the DOM. So those methods are a perfect moment to add an event listener and to remove it. Much easier than what you needed to do in the widget system previously. Okay. Now let's come back to our work on the adding task. For we can now listen to a key-up event. We can extract the task description. Now we need to add it to the task list. So first thing, let us remove the demo data that we had in the app component and just use an empty array, an empty list. Okay. Now the add task callback can simply generate a new task and push that task into this list. That's the code does. And it looks really nice, simple, but it does not work. It does not work. If you try this code, you will see that the input is emptied, and then nothing happens. So why does it not work? It's because OWL does not know that it should render in the user interface. You need reactivity. You need to tell OWL that something changed, something important changed, and that this component should be re-rendered and all its subcomponents as well. To do that, we have important hook, which is useState, which is inspired by React, and it's very nice. This useState hook can be used to wrap an element. In this case, it's imported from the hooks exported by OWL, and then it is used around the task list. And by doing that, OWL is now aware that this list should be observed. In practice, what it will do is to replace the list object by a proxy object. So it can intercept all changes to this object and react on that. And what it will do is simply make the mapping between this object and the component. And whenever this object is modified, the component will be rendered and all its children. And it works with arrays, objects, and nested arrays of objects, and so on, obviously. And if you do that, it will simply just render your application whenever you need to update it. And that's what it's for. Very nice. Okay, now we have a new task to do. It's to let the user toggle those tasks. For now, you can just add a task to your task list, which is very useful. But to make sense of this task list, you need to let the user mark a task as completed. We have, but then, if you think about that, how should you proceed to add that feature? Because you have a big issue which comes right when you think about that. It's that this is the task component is aware when it needs to be toggled, because this is the one that will listen for the click event, but it is not the owner of the state. The task component just receive a task as a prop. So it needs to, it cannot update the props itself. So it needs to tell its parents that it should be, the state of some task should be updated. How to communicate that intent? If you know Odoo widgets, the way it's done usually in that context is by triggering an event which will bubble along the widget tree. Well, in OWL, we cannot do the same, but we can do something very similar. We will trigger a native event. Let me explain here. We will trigger a native event and propagate that event from the bottom to the top. It's an event, so it will be dispatched on the DOM, and you can then use the native T. You can use then the T-on directive to catch this event, and the event payload is available in the event detail key. So let's see at what it looks like once it's implemented. You have the task component listen to the click event, and when it's clicked on, it triggers a business event, a toggle task. You can see it uses dash to separate those words. It's the equivalent of custom events in the widget world. Now we are talking about OWL, so we have those DOM events, but separated by dash. It needs to tell the app component which task is toggled, because from the perspective of the application, it just manages a list of tasks. So let's do that. We can add the ID field to the event, and now we can listen in the app template. We listen to the task to the toggle task event, and we react to it simply by modifying the task is completed flag. And that's it. That's done. Okay. Maybe I should mention that I should explain a little bit more in detail that the payload for the event is available in the detail subkey for the event. That's equivalent to the event data from Odoo widgets. Okay, so that's a really standard process, that a very common OWL workflow. Whenever you need to modify something, it's really common to add an event handler, to react to it, and then to trigger some event to bubble up the component tree, and then the owner of the state that should be modified, modify the state, and this trigger a new render, and that's the way a proper update loop is done in OWL. So, for example, the code that you see on your right will let you delete tasks from the list. And that's exactly what we did with the toggle task. We had a listener, we trigger an event, then we listen for that event, and we update the state. That's it. We don't need to toggle manually tasks or to remove from the DOM. That's OWL's business. Very common workflow. Okay, now we have a basic working task list. Let's discuss some more advanced features. So probably a need that you will encounter is persistence. You want to be able to find your tasks again if you restore your component. And let's do that by using the local storage, because it's very simple for this discussion. So what we need to do is simply read whenever your app component is created, we need to read from the local storage all the existing tasks, and then simply update the task object with those tasks to make sure that they are displayed. And it's a technical point, but you need also to update the next ID field to make sure that the next task has an ID which is unique. Okay, and so that's for the reading part. Now you need to update, to save to the local storage, and to do that, you need to update each method with a set item. That's a little bit of duplication, but we'll come back to that in a little while. So for now, we can save and restore tasks. But what if we need to test? This brings immediately a problem. We have an app component which will import itself local storage. So It makes it difficult to test. It's possible in JavaScript, a lot of things are possible, but it's not the best way to do. And maybe some of you will know where I'm going with that. I'm talking about inversion of control. We want to inject into the app component, we want to inject its dependency, and we don't want the app component to get them himself. We want to give it, to give me the dependency. And so an obvious solution to that is to literally, in a constructor, give to the app a local storage object. It can, then can use it. Very simple, very nice, but it's kind of a poor man's dependency injection, because you have a big problem with that. It only works with the root component. The reason for that is that you only instantiate yourself the root component. All other subcomponents are created by the framework. So how can you inject your local storage instance into your subcomponent? You could do it by using props everywhere, but that would be really annoying. So we have a solution for that problem. Instead of using a global object, we can simply use the environment. Op manage a special key, which is the environment, and which is shared among all components in a tree. And this object env is really useful to store a lot of common things that you may want to inject. For example, a translation function, a bus, or maybe some kind of service, RPC, whatever. So this env object is shared among all elements in the component tree, and we simply can inject what we want in it. And that's what we do it. What do we do here? We simply modify the environment to add a local storage. That's done just on the bottom. And from then, the full application can read the local storage from the environment. Okay, we have a lot of issues with this code. It may be small, but if you are kind of a purist, if you want to have a beautifully designed code which works well, which can be extended, you'll probably notice that you have some issues. You have some code duplication, local storage in particular. The app component does too much. It manages tasks, and it manages local storage, and it manages the rendering of the user interface. You have state management code all over the place, and you have local storage code all over the place. So let's do, as an example, let's refactor our code to separate those concerns. To do that, we can use a different state management strategy. What we can do is inject in the environment a model which will manage the tasks, and we can even make sure that it manages the tasks and the persistence itself. And then this model will be available for all the applications below the app component. So let us do that. First, you have on your left a task model. What it does is basically it takes all the methods coming from the app that were concerned with managing tasks. It lets you add tasks, toggle tasks, and delete them. It manages the next ID field, all of that. But there is something that you may notice: it's not reactive anymore. It's just a list of tasks. It manages them on its own. It's not a component. It cannot use an hook. But it's an event bus. That's an important point. That will be the way this task model will notify the user interface that it should be updated by triggering an event, like it's done in the add task method. Next, you have the stored task model, which is concerned with persistence. This stored task model will read from the local storage, then get those tasks and update itself every time the task model is updated. It's a nice way to extract the persistence concern from the task management concern. But it's not perfect yet. We'll talk about that. Let's go to the way those are used. We have the application component, which will then instantiate a new stored task model. It will take the local storage from the environment, which was injected, and a critical point, it will listen to the update event. That was, remember, that was triggered by the model whenever it was updated. So When this update event comes up, then the app will just call this render method, and that will render the whole user interface. So remember, the flow goes like that. You have your application, which has initial environment model. Whenever we call a method on that model, it will trigger an update, which will be listened by the root component, which will re-render the full application. And all will make sure that it works like you expect it to be. Maybe you should have a look also at the task component, which simply toggle call method on the model directly in its event handlers. Okay, so that's the way you could work, but still it's not perfect, as you probably noticed. One of those issues may be that the store task model is a subclass of the task model. It makes sense as a first implementation. That's why I actually made it. But it breaks some nice solid principles. In this case, it cannot be substituted for a task model. So that's a big issue. And also, usually you want to favor composition over inheritance. So in this case, how could you replace this sub model by using composition? So that's an exercise for you. Another issue that you may want to solve is how to inject this model in the application. Because now, what it does is basically creating it itself, which couples your app component to this model. And what you probably want to do is inject it in the, using the environment as well. Now, using a model is not the perfect strategy for state management. You may want to explore other ideas, maybe using a store. That's a different way to formalize the way that you update your state. Some other improvement that you could make is use the local storage key, which can be configured, which can be changed, because right now it's hard-coded, which makes this component not really reusable in a meaningful way. Now it's really locked to this to-do app key. So it should be configurable. So what's the best way to do that? Another exercise that you could do is using adding filter, the possibility to filter those tasks, because in practice the user may want to display only the tasks that are completed or those that are not completed. It may want to search in those tasks. You may want to edit them. All of those IDs may be added to this to-do list component. So even if it looks like a small example, you have a lot of way to do it, a lot of concerns, a lot of IDs that you can mix to have what you need exactly. And right now, if I remember well, the code for this is currently about 130 lines of code. So it's very small, actually. Even though we spent a long time talking about it, it's very small. It's a nice project to explore all those user interface ideas. So thank you for your attention. I think that this concludes this talk. If you are interested in working with Odoo, with all inside Odoo, there is another talk on that very topic coming right up, and I'll be happy to answer your question right now at the Q&A. Thank you again.
Thank you very much, Jared, for showing us all and how it works. I have seen a lot of remarks about how similar it looks to React. Could you maybe help us understand a bit more why we needed to develop our own framework and why not using React?
Oh, that's a difficult question that I kind of struggled with. So thank you, Vincent, for asking questions like this. So the choice of a specific framework is a difficult problem. We have a lot of different concerns to make sure that we solve with that framework. We knew we needed something new. We needed something more modern, right? But which framework to use was difficult to choose. We actually experimented with a few different frameworks, and it never felt right. The most difficult problem is about handling QWeb templates. So because of that, we try to first have a very small component layer, And that component layer would replace those widgets. And then it kind of grew up slightly, but it's still at a lower level of abstraction than React. So I think we experimented a lot, and OWL is now what we chose to do. And I think it's a core choice. So it's a very long question that we could discuss later if you want on the framework JavaScript Jitsi room later. I'll be around.
Okay,
but thank you. Let's move to the next question, maybe.
Yes, British Study Centers asks, does OWL have a UI component library like other frameworks have, like Utify from Vue?
You mean a component library like dialogues, model component dropdown?
Yeah, I guess like checkboxes and inputs and so on.
Yeah, right. Not now, not for now, because obviously OWL is a very new framework, right? Mm-hmm. And we still are in the process of rewriting our own code in OWL, right? So what we are doing now is working on a dialog widget component, I mean, maybe a navbar component and so on. But it will most likely be integrated in the web client, right?
So Odoo itself then will not have a UI library. It's just a core. It's just a base.
Yeah, not maintained by us for now, at least. We are in the process of growing the OWL ecosystem. There are a lot of stuff to do, right? And a component library is useful, but we'll think about that later.
All right. And there's another question that I just saw pass by. I didn't manage to read who asked it, but will the entire Odoo JavaScript codebase be transformed into OWL?
Oh, that's a nice question. The entire JavaScript codebase. I would love to, but definitely not for now. But what is true is that every new front-end project will most likely use OWL if they need it. But what we will do is translate the full web client and all of the corresponding code in every add-on to OWL, that's for sure. Now, there are other code bases that may need to be updated, such as Odoo SH maybe, or the Runbot, or website. I should have talked about the website. Website is for now not done in OWL. You can use OWL, but it's not made in OWL yet. Maybe someday.
Okay. And you use the word translate. Does that mean that passing from a widget to Odoo code is a straightforward process, or like what kind of process is that exactly?
It's more about understanding what your widget does, and then actually modeling again what it does. So you probably need to, as I did in the talk, you need to think about the state and the props. And then from then, you just write your template. And the process is very easy. If you are used to React or Vue, I can tell you that using OWL will feel very natural compared to widgets before that.
Oh, so people can build on their own knowledge of existing frameworks?
Yes, yes. OWL. It's so much closer to the state of the art, well-known frameworks. So we know in-house, we know that every new member of our team or everywhere could learn OWL in a few minutes, maybe, but maybe it's a little bit ambitious,
yeah.
but very, very quickly anyway. Mm-hmm. And it feels natural to use a template, QWeb, and bind your event handler and your class, your TIT, your dynamic attributes, everything. It's very simple.
Okay. I have a few more detailed questions now about what you showed in your presentation. Mm-hmm. One of them was, can a single Odoo page contain several OWL root widget components? Root components, sorry, not widgets.
Yeah, a good question. The answer for that is definitely yes. That's actually what we do in Odoo version 14. In Odoo version 14, if you look at our own use of OWL, you'll find that we have many OWL routes. For example, the Discus application has its own application OWL routes application. You have all of our code that was converted is actually a new OWL root. So there is not really any technical issue with that. However, I would say that it's not a good sign of a good design. I would suggest for a brand new application to have a single use and a simple component tree. A simple mental model is important too, you know?
Yeah, okay. So that goes along with organizing your state. You have to understand the entire state and then divide that into components and choose which one will be the root one.
Yeah, yeah. working on user interface, you need to have a simple model of what's going on. Otherwise, you will just be lost. It's easy to be overwhelmed by what can happen. So a simple component tree is better if you can, of course.
Okay. About the assets and the templates, is it possible to load XML or HTML templates from external files and not inline them like you showed?
Yes. The QWeb, the old QWeb implementation has a global method to register new templates. And you can, that's what we use in our experimental work on the new web client. What we are doing is rewriting the fundamental part of the web client in OWL. And that's what we do. We just fetch the XML file, a bundle of XML files.
Like it is today now?
Just like today. And then we feed it to the OWL renderer. That's it.
Okay, one last short question.
Very, very quick then.
Inline templates be XPathed or translated?
Because the XPath is just done server-side, and we don't have, for now, maybe someday, but for now, we don't have any XPath feature on the front-end side. So we just can't do it without writing that code, but maybe someday. But I would say that those inline templates are very useful for quick prototyping work, but that's it.
Okay, thank you very much, Jerry, for all your information and all your questions. I guess people can join the JavaScript framework room if they have more questions about OWL or how it will be rewritten in general. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vincent.